morning, Church Online. I want to welcome you guys to stand at your feet at home. I hope you're excited to worship. Let's worship together.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings.
Failing love that you would.
You made.
that they would feel like they hadn't had a drink in so long, but Lord, that you would just quench that thirst, that they would just have this peace that washes over them. Lord, I just pray that you would calm the rough waters that they may be facing. God, that you would calm in their spirit. Lord, I come against any anxiety that's trying to sneak in this season. And Lord, we just find rest in you, oh God.
You're a lamp unto my feet, oh God. And all my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Yes, Lord. Father, today we are so thankful for your presence in our midst and in our homes. And today we are so thankful that you are good, that in every season, that in every moment, that in every set of circumstances, that you are good. So today, Lord, we honor you. We give you praise. We give you glory. And we rejoice today in you and in your presence and in your goodness, for you are worthy. We thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen, amen. What a good time of worship today, and what a good opportunity to remind ourselves that God is good. And not just good in a general way, but that he's good to me, that he's good to you. Amen? Amen, amen. So good. So let me share with you just a couple of things here before we kind of transition into hearing a great message today. First, we want to welcome you. If you are visiting us online today and you are not a part of Living Hope, we want to welcome you and thank you for joining with us, for tuning in today, participating with us at church online. And we would love it if you would do us a favor. If you click the I Attend a Church link that is below the video here, we would love to send you a gift just to thank you for visiting with us online. And so if you click that link, fill out the form. This week you could check your inbox and you will find a small gift from us to you, just a thank you for tuning in today. And we hope that you enjoy your time worshiping with us today online. You know, one of the things that is really important to us at Living Hope is being connected. And I don't think I have to convince you that that's an important thing, right? We all know during this season where so many of us have been isolated, we all understand how important it is that we be connected. But we believe that Christianity, that following Jesus, is not something that is meant to be done in isolation or meant to be done by ourselves, but that we do it with others and we do it in community. So at Living Hope, we have small groups at Living Hope. We call them connect groups or C groups. And these groups meet in homes all throughout our city normally. And they meet biweekly, twice a month, in order to gather together for fellowship, for friendship, as well as to share the experience of following Jesus together. Of course, during this season, because of the miracle of technology, our C groups are able to continue to meet online. And so I thought this would be a good moment to encourage you that if you are not connected to one of our small groups, then we would encourage you to do so. We believe that being a part of our small groups can be a real blessing to your life and give you an opportunity to be connected. So if that's something that interests you, you can visit our website at findhope.tv. You can find the Connect tab, and you can fill out a form there to let us know that you are interested in getting connected to one of our C groups, and someone will get in touch with you to give you some more information and to help you get connected. So listen, you don't need to be alone during this season, and so please, if you're not in one of our small groups, in one of our Connect groups, go to the website, fill out the form, and get connected. Amen? Awesome. Listen, we have a great thing right now. Paul Neeson is going to come, and he's just got a great story and testimony that he's going to share from his own life. So let's listen to what Paul has to share with us today.
Thanks, Pastor Jeff. This last year has been amazing. It's been tumultuous. It's been a roller coaster. And thank God that God is at the head of that roller coaster. Before I start, just want to give a quick thank you to this amazing church. I've been a part of this church for 30 years almost now, and never has this church been better than it has today. I've never been more proud and had more love for this church than I do right now. And I thank you to all the leadership and all the volunteers for making it happen through Amen. All these COVID seasons. Insert applause here. Okay. So to move on, guys. Hello to everybody out there in TV land. Sorry, an old Ed Sullivan kind of line. Thought I'd throw that whoever he was. So it started back on March 30th of last year. I was taking a nice bubble bath. I was enjoying it. And it was just foam up to here. And my wife comes in the bathroom, and I'm saying, I'm thinking, and she's got the phone, right? And it's like, your boss is on the phone. Like, what's going on? I'm thinking, it's probably not a promotion to being like CEO or something, I'm probably thinking. And it's like, so she hands me the phone. It's like, this can't be good. It's like, Paul, I'm sorry, but we're going to have to lay off indefinitely. Maybe till about August. We're going to work through it. We got to be lean and mean. COVID hit. Here we go. So obviously I was thinking, wow, my timetable is wide open right now. Here we go. So it's like, what do I do? Lord, I need to hear from you in every which way. How do I fill it? By thinking about you first. So the first thing he says to me is clean the neighborhoods. It's like, what? You know, he must have meant meet with the neighborhood, have a barbecue with the neighborhood. No, Paul, I said clean. What do you mean? What do you mean clean? So I would do my prayer walks, and I'd start going out and just cleaning everywhere I went for every morning, and still do that to that point. But that's not because of me. That's because of God. That's not because of what was in me. I didn't want to do that at all. It's like he wanted me to get the most humble I could possibly be. So I went through the summer, obviously, thinking, okay, when are they going to call me back? August, they call me back. And we put the biggest fall campaign on like you wouldn't believe to try and get the sales going, to make up for the time that was lost. And, of course, it's hard to do that. So if I called your home, you know, forgive me, I didn't mean to do that. So on the sales campaign, you have to forgive me now. So anyway, so went through that, and I was thinking in the back of my mind, you know what, I'm probably one step closer to the exit door because of being laid off. And God said to me again, get ready for the new year. Get ready for the new year. I go, okay, didn't know what, but here we go. So January 7th comes, and I'm on the Zoom call like everybody does these days. And the general manager is a part of it and normally isn't, so I'm thinking, here we go. Sure enough, here we go. Packaged out. Okay. So if once again, Lord, I need to hear from you. So in February, I get this vision. I'm in a park, and I wasn't even praying this way, but it was like all these doors were lined up, all these white doors, and they're all locked, and I was trying to get into each and every one, and it wouldn't happen, and nothing opened. And then I saw God way down, like one of the final doors, and he said, down here, I'm over here, come on in. And this huge light coming out of this one door, and God said, it's important what you say no to just as much as it's important what you say yes to. Very important. So I never forgot that. Because there were a lot of other offers, not a lot, but a few, that I said no to. And I didn't want to muddy the waters to be ready for God to use me when he needed to use me. So then moving along to mid-February, I get the call out of the blue for doing interviews. And a series of interviews later, the blessing landed. God was good. God is always good. He is amazing. The job offer came better than ever, than I've ever had in my whole life. Double the pay almost, a car, a laptop, you know, RSP that's matched. It's like over and over again. My prayer needs were here. His response was there. It was unbelievable. Unbelievable. I didn't even pray for some of the things that he gave me. Like a faith-based company. Are you kidding me? I don't even pray for that because that just isn't out there. But this was the faith-based company. And they said, Paul, one of the things between you and the other guy that came down to you was the fact that you're a believer and you spend a lot of your time in the church and doing church things. It's like, wow, you kidding me? A lot of companies that would kick you right out and then they would move on to somebody else, but not this company. So I'm just so blessed to be a part of this company, to see exactly before there was no way, and now there's God's way. And I truly, when I was in my devotions this morning, God gave me this verse. Everybody knows it. Psalm 23, verse 1. The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. Amen. That verse alone is enough for the whole Bible, guys. Enough for the whole Bible. We don't even need the rest of the Bible. That's meant more to me this year than any other year. And I thank you, Lord, for what you've brought me through this year.
Amen. Well, that's so awesome. We'll keep the rest of the Bible, though.
Yeah, we won't throw it out. Yeah, we'll do that.
A couple of things that stood out to me from your story, Paul, was one is I thought how easy it would be for so many of us, and I include myself in that, that when something that is you know, kind of devastating, like losing a job can happen that really changes your life, it could be so easy for us to get into kind of self-pity mode, right? Yeah. And, you know, to kind of sit around because you got that extra time on your hand hands and to kind of wallow in the misery of, you know, of the moment. And yet you decided you were going to make the most of that time and do some things that were going to be a benefit to others. And, you know, you continue to serve around the church here. In fact, you volunteered to do extra things around the church. I know you picked up some side jobs to help supplement some income a little bit and clean up the neighborhood and everything. And you know, that's something that stood out to me. In addition to that is the importance of hearing from God, you know, in that, you know, through that season, and to say, wow, so important that as followers of Jesus, that when we find ourselves in tumultuous circumstances, that we listen to the voice of the Holy Spirit as God wants to reveal his will to us and lead us through that season. Amen? Amen. So we're going to take a moment and just pray. And we know there's a lot of people who are participating today and watching with us online that also find themselves in a moment of real need. And would you just pray for every one of them and just really ask maybe two things. One is that they will hear the voice of the Holy Spirit speaking to them and leading them and guiding them during this season, and also that God will meet their need in an abundant and miraculous way like he did for you.
Amen. Lord, I thank you so much for the ability to hear from you, O Lord God. How important that is, O Lord. Holy Spirit, I pray right now for those at home, wherever you are, Lord, that they would hear clearly exactly what they need to do from you, O Lord Jesus, and then they would do it. I thank you, Lord Jesus, for the ability, O Lord Jesus, to hear from you, for your Holy Spirit, for your power, O Lord God, to go forth, O Lord Jesus. I just pray your hand upon each one, that each and every prayer would be answered, O Lord God. Those 10-year-old, 20-year-old, whatever, 30-year-old prayers, knock the dust out of them, get the cobwebs off of them, and just watch and see what happens when God takes over and he's got the steering wheel. And I thank you, Lord Jesus, for what you're doing today. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
Amen. So good. Thank you, Paul. Thank you. All right, church, listen, we are in for a real treat this morning. Pastor Jason is going to be continuing our series on dreams and specifically going to be sharing with us about God's heart for our family. So grab your phone or your device or whatever you use to follow along and take notes. And let's get ready to hear a great message from Pastor Jason today.
Come on. So good. Paul, that was fantastic. Here, I'm going to do this. Sam, you want to thank you. What an absolutely great story, great testimony, church. I hope that encourages you. Come on, no matter what's going on around you, God is in control. Amen? That was fantastic. Paul, you sound like you landed the right spot. I want to share something cool with you. You know, Paul mentioned how he's never been more proud to be part of this church than right now, and I echo his sentiments. I've been in this church my entire life. Yes, all 43 years. And I too have never been more proud of you guys, our church family. Just the way that you've rolled up your sleeves, gotten on your knees, and said, we're going to be the church of Jesus. We started a street ministry, as you know. When I say we, you, people in our church, God sparked this in their hearts, and they began a street ministry when all the tent cities began to pop up. This last year, about a year ago. And I want to let you know that as of this last week, they have had 10 people pray to accept Jesus into their lives on the streets. Come on, give God a hand in your homes, in your apartments this morning. Come on, 10 decisions for Jesus. We can't share a lot of things online, of course, you know, just for privacy purposes and that kind of thing. Jen told me I could obviously share this exciting news with you. They sent me a picture of Walter holding a flashlight. You know, they're out there Thursday night, dark, holding a flashlight so a new believer could read the Gospel of John on the streets. They connected with an organization that has mailed us 300 Gospels of John for free. They gave them to us for free, hearing what we're doing on the streets. And I love the continuation of legacy there. You'll remember my dad, when he got saved over in the Middle East, he had a little Gospel of John with him. That's what he was reading. And what God was using to draw him. And we're seeing God do the same thing today. There's a pizza place down in the West End called Right Wingers, Right Wingers Pizza and Wings. They were approached by Claire, who was in our church, and she said what they were told them what we're doing Thursday nights on the streets, and asked if they'd be willing to donate a pizza to her so she could bring down, and they gave her three pizzas to bring down. I'd encourage you, if you got a hankering for some pizza, head to Right Wingers and let them know that you're part of the church and that you're so grateful that they're willing to partner with us like that. They've done it again since. They've given some more freebies our way. Come on, God is at work, and you are being the church. And so I echo what Paul said, that this is just an awesome, awesome time right now in the history of our church. Oh, I love this. I love it when the media team forgets to start my countdown, because in my mind, that means I still have 30 full minutes starting right here, right now. Yes, I'm talking to you, Cassidy, back there. She was trash-talking me earlier about our fantasy hockey league, so there's some public payback for you. God's heart for your family. How many know God has a heart for families? I want to make this clear as I start. God's heart for your family. Some of you might think, well, I'm already, grown and my kids are grown. I don't really have kids that I influence, or maybe I'm single or I don't yet have kids, or maybe I've never had kids. What I'm going to share today is really, and I probably could have called this message this, but it's God's heart for generations. And all of us play a role in this. They started that timer as soon as I said that. We all play a role in this, regardless of whether you have natural kids or not. How many know that in the kingdom, we're all called to have spiritual children? Let me hear an amen from you. I will believe that it happened. Acts 3, verse 12, we're going to start. Acts 3, verse 12. People of Israel, what is so surprising about this, and why stare at us as though we have made this man walk by our own power? It is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of all of our ancestors who brought this glory to his servant Jesus. Okay, so here we have a moment where Peter's responding to miracles that are happening. And this is in the book of Acts, and he refers to the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Now, Abraham was alive roughly 2,000 years earlier. He's in the middle of a message, in the middle of explaining to these guys what's going on. He refers to somebody who was alive 2,000 years earlier. And I'm not going to get into all the details of the Abrahamic covenant, although I would highly recommend that you look up, Lanny Hubbard or Ken Mallman or any of those fellows' books on covenants and on the biblical covenants, Kevin Connor. There's just so much gold wrapped up in there. And so I'm not going to get into all those details, but I want you to understand something. Right there in that moment, while Peter is speaking in the book of Acts, he understands that God's will and God's purposes go from generation to generation to generation to generation. He knew that it wasn't just right there, right now, that was all that mattered. He understood this is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And we're going to use that as our framework today to encourage you and remind you that God is not finished with you yet. In fact, he's just getting started with you, and he has great plans and purposes for you and the next generation. First thing I want us to look at is multi-generational blessing. Say it to someone with you there, multi-generational blessing. And if you're by yourself, just yell these things back at me. I love it. Deuteronomy 11, starting in verse 1. I would really love a water if somebody in the room would mind. Yeah, thanks. Appreciate it. Water would be great. Deuteronomy 11, starting in verse 1. Okay, catch some of the key phrases here. You must love the Lord your God and always obey his requirements, decrees, regulations, and commands. Keep in mind that I am not talking now to your children who've not yet experienced the discipline of the Lord or seen his greatness and strong, powerful arm. They didn't see all the miraculous signs and wonders he performed in Egypt against Pharaoh. They didn't see what the Lord did to those armies of Egypt, to their horses and chariots, how he drowned them all in the Red Sea. He destroyed them, and they've not recovered to this day. Your children didn't see how the Lord called you in the wilderness, cared for you in the wilderness until you arrived here. And he goes on and on and on, speaking to them. Your children have not yet experienced these things. But verse 7, you have seen the Lord perform all these mighty deeds with your own eyes. Now I'm going to jump ahead to verse 18. So we're still in Deuteronomy 11, and I'm going to jump ahead to verse 18. Yeah, you can lob it. Thank you. Appreciate it, Heather. Jump ahead to verse 18 with me. Commit yourselves wholeheartedly to these words of mine. Tie them to your hands and wear them on your foreheads as reminders. We talked about this a couple months ago. Teach them to your children. Talk about them at home, on the road, going to bed, getting up. Write them on the doorposts of your houses and your gates. So as long as the sky remains above the earth, you and your children may flourish in the land that the Lord gave your ancestors. Be careful to obey these commands I'm giving you. Show your love to the Lord by walking in his ways and holding tightly to him. Then the Lord will drive out the nations ahead of you, even though they're greater and stronger than you. You will take over their land. Wherever you set your foot, that land will be yours. Your frontiers will stretch from the wilderness in the south to Lebanon in the north, the Euphrates River in the east to the Mediterranean in the west. No one will be able to stand against you because the Lord your God will cause people to fear and dread you as he promised wherever you go. Verse 26, look, I'm giving you a choice today between a blessing and a curse. You will be blessed if you obey the commands of the Lord that I'm giving you, but you'll be cursed if you reject them. And if you turn from God and worship gods you've not known before. The phrase, be careful, is repeated 5 times here in 32 verses. Okay, that's quite a number of times for something to be repeated in such a short period of time. 4 of the times it says we're instructed to be careful to obey the commands. And then the 5th time, we're instructed to be careful to not let our heart be deceived. There's a reason this is in here, as is everything in Scripture. And yes, Paul, yes, we'll keep the rest of the Bible, but I hear what you're saying. Love your heart. There's going to be many opportunities along the journey of life to be deceived. There's going to be many opportunities along the journey of life to begin to worship other gods, to begin to turn from the ways of God. And this is why he's repeating this over and over and over, to make sure that we're aware of it. Don't ever get to the point where you think, oh, I could never, fall to the wayside or take a wrong path or turn from God. Nobody who's turned from God has ever planned on it. We've got to be careful to live the way that is instructed to us. He loves you, and he loves your children, and he loves future generations so much that he's willing to repeatedly warn us and repeatedly remind us of what we need to do to trust him for success for the generations. See, we've got to understand as Christians, we're called to live in the world, but not of the world. Sadly, in too much of Christianity, kind of globally, I see too much of it watered down. Someone mentioned to me after Easter how they were appreciative that I spoke about the realities of eternity, the reality of heaven and hell in an Easter message. And they said that the realities of hell are really not preached about much anymore, it feels like, in our culture, and especially not on a special weekend like Easter. And my response is, the reality of heaven and the reality of hell is literally why we're here celebrating what Jesus did. Jesus gave up his life so that we could live with an assurance that we will spend eternity in him, in heaven with him and not apart from him in hell. We can't water down our faith because some people don't like that God is very just and very black and white, and there is literally only one way to eternity with him. We don't want to remove the realities of God's truth. And we've got to make sure we don't do that with the next generation. Can I hear an amen? Thank you. I have one lone voice in here yelling amen back at me. They were telling me before church I need to bring like Lynn Moore and Gillian and Cindy Morrison and bring them here just to yell and scream back at me when I'm in an empty room. Worshipping other gods, make sure you don't miss this. It's not just, building a golden calf. Like as if any of us are going to do that today, build a big thing out of gold and worship it. No, there's so many other things that become idols and false gods that we worship and that we lift higher than anything else in our culture. You see nature, you see money, you see relationships, immorality, fame, technology, computers, politics. I mean, the list goes on and on and on and on of things that have become gods in our society, things that have become gods in our culture. Pass these instructions on to your children. You heard that repeated in this passage. I want to ask you today, what are you passing on to the next generation? To your own kids, but also to all of the next generation, right? All the young people in our church and in our community, in your extended family. We're all passing something on. I want it to be something that points them to a God and sets them on a path for a life in love with Jesus. You know, Heidi Grenk is one of my favorite people all time for this. She has passed on the truth, the love, the gospel of Jesus to countless young people, probably into the thousands now, throughout her decades of ministering to kids and to teenagers. That's called passing on to the next generation. That's called doing what is in your hands to do to make sure that I'm going to be faithful to pass this message on. What they do with it, yes, we all grow up. We all make our own decisions. You can't control that. But boy, when they're young, and when you know kids are young, when teenagers are young, young adults, we're going to pass on the truths of the Word of God and set them on a path for success. Okay, God's heart is multi-generational blessing, but he lays out the choice very clearly. Blessing this way, curse this way. Number two, I want you to see God's heart for generations. We see this again in Exodus 20, verse 5. Do not bow down or worship any other gods, because I am a jealous God. I'm not going to tolerate your affection for other gods. I lay the sins of the parents on their children, and the entire family is affected, even to the third and fourth generation of those who reject me. But I lavish unfailing love for 1,000 generations on those who obey me and who keep my commands. Oh man, the language in here, I'll get to it in a minute, but this is brilliant. You've got to be sure you get this. One of the Bible commentaries I was studying with says this about this passage. Parents' extravagance can leave their children beggars. To be the son of a felon is to be handicapped in the race of life. The knowledge that their sin will put their children at a disadvantage is spoken about intentionally here to check them in their evil causes. Still, the penalty on children is not final and it's not irreversible. Under whatever disadvantages they are born, they may push back against them, they may struggle against them, and they may lead good lives and place themselves on level ground with those who were born under favorable circumstances. This is what this passage is getting at. As it respects eternity, another world, their parents' sin will not be visited upon them. Each man will bear his own burden. The soul that sins will die. The son won't bear the iniquity of the father, nor will the father bear the iniquity of the son. The righteousness of the righteous will be on him. The wickedness of the wicked will be on him, Ezekiel 18:20. So the commentary here is letting us know that what we pass on to the next generation truly affects them. But, thanks be to God, we will all stand before him one day and give an account for us. Again, there's so much in our culture today that is backwards and wrong. It feels like every day there's something new that's just idiotic that comes out as truth. One of the things that you hear circulating is that you are responsible for something someone did generations ago. No, you're not. You will stand before God and give an account for your life. But will the previous sins of previous generations handicap us to start off? Yeah. Sin has consequences. Choosing a blessing and choosing a curse, both choices have consequences. But here's what I want you to get, and here's what God's getting at with the language about generations here. It uses the phrase, the sin will affect 3 or 4 generations. Now understand, there can still be restoration. There can still be forgiveness. There can still be new life. The gospel of Jesus is not nullified in this passage. The heart of God is simply being shown. But we, you know, how we live and what we open up the next generation to can impact them. I remember chatting with a friend, who's in ministry, and older, quite a bit older than I am, you know, a couple decades, being my dad's generation or thereabouts. And got saved, you know, back in the, I think, you know, 60s, 70s, hippie drug days, and was heavily into alcohol, as was his parents, and as far as he knew, as far back as he knew. And I remember him sharing with me once as he started to watch young generations of Christians want to drink and want to start to open doors again. And he was like, look, I don't care about, you know, the way you can try to thread a needle and remove all responsibility of influence and things are permissible but not beneficial. Do all the fancy, you know, mental manipulation you can to land at the point that says, I am allowed to drink. He said, I just can't get it because I saw it devastating generation after generation. Why would anybody want to even touch that door? And I remember him just expressing, I don't get it. And now, you know, this was a while ago, this conversation. And sadly, we have seen in many church circles that have, if you will, decided, like, yeah, you know what? Go ahead, have at it. I know of people personally who have had to been relieved of their duties in church leadership because they become alcoholics, and they were raised to never have touched the stuff. But because I'm free to do it, they opened up a door, and the enemy seized on the opportunity. See, what we do will affect generations and affect future generations. But get God's heart. He says, those who obey my love and commands, I will pour out the blessing upon 1,000 generations. You know what 1,000 is referring to here? Forever. And what we're catching is the heart of God. His mercy in this instance, his mercy transcends his righteous anger. He's saying for 3 to 4 generations, the sin may affect, but for 1,000 generations, the choice to follow and the choice to obey is something that I wanna just lavish forever and ever and ever. His heart is that your family and their kids and their kids and their kids and their kids know the goodness and the blessing and the favor of God. Can I hear an amen? You know, one of the ways we got where we've gotten to as a society is the removal of God. The removal of God from schools, the removal of God from leadership, from government, the removal of godly values and godly principles. Deuteronomy 8, verse 19 reminds us, if you ever forget the Lord your God and you start to follow other gods, you will certainly be destroyed. Just as the Lord has destroyed other nations in your past, in your path, you will be destroyed if you refuse to obey. This is why our work in discipleship is so important. Helping others find and follow Jesus is so, so, so important. There's a reason the family has been under attack for decades and really for generations. Satan understands the power of family. Satan understands God's heart for generations, and he wants to try to instill threads and generational curses of brokenness and addiction and pain, and he'll do whatever he can to bring about the destruction of family. We used to get this, even as a secular society. In my lifetime, we used to understand the absolute vitality of family, and sadly, the enemy has veered the discussion so far off track now, you don't even hear about this anymore. There's a Sports Illustrated headline here that I pulled up from the mid-90s. This is not that long ago, okay, mid-90s. I know it seems like a long time ago. Some of you weren't alive then. Many of you weren't. Probably almost none of you caught Paul's joke at the beginning there about Ed Sullivan. Here's a headline. It's called Where's Daddy? And it shows a little kid. I can't remember if he was alone or what the picture was. And the whole issue was about the epidemic of fatherlessness among pro athletes and all the kids that are being born, but the dads aren't around. And I just pulled a couple quotes here from it. This was written by Sports Illustrated. This is not a Christian organization. This wasn't a church. This was Sports Illustrated in the mid-90s, not that long ago. Here's one of the quotes. There are probably more kids out of wedlock than there are players in the NBA right now, says one of the league's top agents, who said he spends more of his time dealing with paternity claims than negotiating contracts. According to a 1995 survey, so this article would have been around 96-ish. According to a 1995 survey, National Center for Health, 32% of U.S. children are born to unmarried mothers compared to 18% in 1980. Almost doubled in 15 years, and sadly has continued to go up since then. The issue of family structure in our society goes far beyond sports, and it goes on to lay out the devastating impacts of being raised without a father, and the devastating impacts in health and in education and in just mindset and just the strength and determination to live a life. This article would never get published today. Never in a billion years would Sports Illustrated published this thing today. Today, we just sweep it under the carpet and we keep glorifying sex. We keep glorifying immorality. We keep glorifying the big party and drug scene and sleep around and do this, that, and the other. And we completely brush under the carpet the human carnage and suffering coming to the next generation because of it. The Canadian Association for Equality has some stats. There are 150,000 single parent families in Canada, with sadly 80% of them being led by single moms. 80% of single families are led by single moms. Children from fatherless families are 10 times more likely to abuse substances, 4 times more likely to be raised in poverty. These are now current stats. to be raised in poverty, twice as likely to commit suicide, and 9 times more likely to drop out of high school. 70%, yes, 70% of teen pregnancies occur in fatherless homes. And girls are 9 times more likely to be sexually assaulted in a home without a father. The official government stats show us that fatherlessness is a pressing issue in society and contributes to a host of social problems. This is from the Canadian Association of Equality. Fatherhood should be praised and encouraged as a source of pride and meaning for fathers, not just being the breadwinner. Children who are deprived of fathers have less economic benefits, supervision, guidance, and protection, and they suffer from less emotional support and feelings of abandonment. Now, I want to say this. Make sure that I don't leave anybody super discouraged here today. Single moms who are watching, and single dads, 20% are single dads. I want you to remember something. No matter what the statistics show, God is the Redeemer. Your child will not miss out on a single thing if you will raise them in the ways of God. All the stats will not apply to them as you repent and as you live your life for Jesus and you raise that next generation to know and to follow him. He will make all things new. He will redeem the past. He will. This is what he does. This is what the cross is all about. Forgiveness and setting us on a new course. So I don't want you to hear this and think, wow, so we're at a huge disadvantage and there's nothing we can do about it. Oh no, there's plenty that can be done about it. That's the God that you serve. So be encouraged today, you single parents who work hard. I can't imagine what it's like. Be encouraged to know that God is right there redeeming your efforts. God is watching over your kids and their future is bright. But we have to be sure that as Christians and as a society, we don't gloss over these statistics. These are real impacts. These are real impacts of the destruction of the family unit. Third thing I want us to look at here as we get ready to wrap up in a few minutes is Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Back to that statement Peter made 2,000 years after Abraham. And we see it all through Scripture. Right back to Genesis. Genesis 17, verse 1. When Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to him and said, I am El Shaddai, God Almighty. Serve me faithfully and live a blameless life. I will make a covenant with you where I will guarantee to give you countless descendants. Abram fell face down on the ground, and God said, this is my covenant with you. I'll make you a father of a multitude of nations. 99 years old, what a moment this is. What's more, I'm changing your name. It's no longer Abram. Instead, you'll be called Abraham, for you will be the father of many nations. I will make you extremely fruitful. Your descendants will become many nations and kings will be among them. I'll confirm my covenant with you and your descendants after you from generation to generation to generation. This is the everlasting covenant. I will always be your God and the God of the descendants after you. How many receive that for your own lives and your own descendants here this morning? The name Abram in Hebrew means exalted father or high father. The name Abraham means father of the Jewish nation or father of multitudes. His name was changed to the father of multitudes. Understand, God's heart is for generations, multiple. Everything is laid out before him. You and I just see time in a very limited way. God's heart is for generation and generation and generation. I've had several conversations with people in our church the last number of months, and even some outside of our church. Parents expressing concern about the future for their kids. What kind of future will there be here where we live in our nation? I'm kind of concerned about the future. I'm concerned about stability. I'm concerned about their career opportunities and the spirit that seems to kind of pervade everything these days. And real good heartfelt conversations. And as Christians, where I've been always amazed the conversations come back to, and this is what I want to remind you of today. You want your life, and I want my life to be planted exactly where God wants it. Period. End of story. Chasing after what might seem like better natural opportunities or better, education opportunities or anything, something that might look to jive with your values. It may make sense on the surface, but if God hasn't called you to move or to do this or to change this, don't change anything. Like Paul said, sometimes the doors we say no to are just as important as the ones we say yes to. And I get it. I get the angst. I get a lot of people, seeing like just this Like, what's going to be around for my kids other than a mountain of debt, of federal debt? What's going to be left for my kids? I want to remind you of something. Your child's destiny is not in the hands of a person. It's not in the hands of a government. It's not in the hands of anybody else. It's in the hands of God. The next generation's call and destiny is not suddenly changed because life gets flipped upside down. God sees the beginning from the end, and his destiny, his plan, and his purpose for your kids and their kids and their kids and their kids, it will come to pass as we obey his commands and we pass it on to the next generation. The enemy has no way to derail the plan and purpose of God unless we let him derail our commitment and derail what we're living for and who we're living for. Nothing takes God by surprise. Say it back to me. Nothing takes God by surprise. Love it. I love it. At the end of the day, I want my life to be positioned right where God has me positioned. Some people were saying to me recently, you know, our church, we believe, and we've had it prophesied that we'll start, you know, campuses or other churches or locations around the world. And some people were saying, I want to be on the Florida launch team. I'm ready. Let's go. I'm ready to launch even here. People are cheering, clapping. I want to be on the Florida launch team now, okay? Complete liberty and freedom, unbelievable weather, beautiful beaches. And, you know, there's like a big sign up. I said, what about the Alaska or the Greenland or the Northern Quebec campus? Who wants to be part of that one? Nobody. Crickets. I said, if you guys do a Florida campus, I want to make that the filming campus where I have to do my filming. How's that for a deal? I want to be right where God has called me. And I understand in my own life and my own family, I am called right here, right now for such a time as this. The enemy can try to do what he wants, but God's will prevail. God's purposes will prevail. God's plans will prevail because God alone sits on the throne, nobody else. Acts 2, verse 17, in the last days I will pour out my spirit on all people. Say all. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. I will pour out my spirit on servants, men and women alike, and they will all prophesy. I will cause wonders in the heavens above and signs on the earth below. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. I love the picture painted here of multiple generations working together, dreaming together, prophesying and speaking life together. Guess what? As the world gets darker, there's going to need to be more of you and I speaking life into it, speaking hope into your neighbors, speaking hope into your friends and your coworkers. The Bible makes it clear there will be a great harvest when the time to finish comes, but prior to that, buckle up. It's not necessarily going to be an easy ride, but our voices, and more importantly, the presence and spirit of God in us is so needed for the world around us and for the generation who's looking up to us and who's watching us. And that's why I say this impacts all of us, not just those with kids. Genesis 26, the Lord appeared to Isaac and said, "Don't go to Egypt, but do what I tell you. Live here as a foreigner in this land, and I will bless you and be with you. I will confirm that I will give this land to you and your descendants, just as I promised to Abraham, your father. I will cause your descendants to become numerous as stars of the sky, and I will give them all these lands. And through your descendants, all the nations of the earth will be blessed. I will do this because Abraham listened to me, and he obeyed my requirements, my commands, my decrees, and my instructions." Don't think for a second that how we live doesn't impact the next generation. It does. So the God of Abraham has now become the God of Abraham and Isaac in this moment right here. Isaac now becomes a source of future blessing for generations. Genesis 28, verse 12. I am the Lord your God, the God of your grandfather Abraham, the God of your father Isaac. The ground you are lying on belongs to you, and I'm giving it to you and your descendants. You see, God keeps repeating his covenant. He keeps repeating his promises. Your descendants will be as numerous as the dust of the earth. They'll spread out in all directions, the west to the east to the north and the south. Then all families of the earth will be blessed through you and your descendants. Now he's become the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. as Jacob has this encounter. Note the three elements of each one. Abraham is the father, the patriarch. God speaks the vision. God speaks the covenant. God speaks the long-term plan to him, and his radical obedience paves the way for it to actually happen. Isaac is a conduit of the blessing. Isaac becomes one who now is a blessing to all nations, and he will be a conduit that his dad's inheritance, his dad's covenant, comes to pass through him. And then Jacob wrestles with the angel at Peniel and has a life-changing encounter with God. I want to encourage you here this morning, all three of these are for you today, right now. God wants to speak vision into you. God wants to speak vision into fathers. God wants to speak dreams. And God is going to use you to be someone who begins to speak about his plan and purposes for generation. And then God wants you to be a blessing to those around you. He wants you to be a blessing to those around you, just like Isaac. And then he wants you and I to have a life-changing, radical encounter with the Holy Spirit. A life-changing, radical encounter with the Holy Spirit, and to bring the presence of God everywhere we go. He isn't just the God of Abraham. He isn't just the God of Isaac. He isn't just the God of Jacob. He's the God of all three. And he's your God, and he's my God, if we will love him and follow his decrees and follow his commands. God has great plans for you, regardless of your age, regardless of your stage of life, regardless of any of the natural things that the world may say sets you back or gives you an advantage. No, no, no. With God, he's the advantage. And he has great plans and great purposes for you. I believe God wants you to start dreaming big dreams again for your family. The enemy's been destroying and trying to crush dreams. God wants you to dream big dreams again. He wants you to dream big dreams for your kids and your grandkids and their kids. Your kids are going to be kingdom builders. Your kids are going to be influencers. Your kids are going to be educators. They're going to work in government. They're going to work in business. They're going to launch churches. They're going to record worship albums. They're going to go on the mission field. Your kids have a call of God on their life. The next generation in our church has a call of God on their lives. Every single kid, youth, and young adult in our church is called and destined by God to accomplish great things. I believe that our dreams should be getting bigger, not smaller. Because the kingdom of God is getting bigger, not smaller. His plans and his purposes are getting bigger, not smaller. He is leading towards the greatest incoming harvest that has ever been seen before. And he wants you and I to be a part of it. He wants you and I to have a role. I want to encourage you this morning, fix your eyes back on him. Don't believe that anybody else holds the destiny of the next generation in their hands. God and God alone holds it. God and God alone holds it. And his heart is for your family. Some of you have kids who have just decided, I'm out of here. I'm taking off. I want nothing to do with you or God. I'm going to see what the world has to offer, like the prodigal son. God knows exactly where they are every second of the day. His presence and his spirit is tugging at their hearts all the time. Your prayers matter. Your prayers work. Don't fixate just on what you see in the natural, but believe that God is bringing prodigals home. God is going to do a work of restoration that no human could ever have fathomed, could ever have imagined happening. There will be a restoration that happens in your homes, in your families, in your relationships. There is going to be a Holy Spirit encounter like Jacob had, and it is going to radically shake the next generation and the one after that. And they're going to get into these secular universities and all these places around us that seem to hate God and hate the things of God, and they're going to see revival break out. They're going to see the presence of God break out. You see, as society continues to live more and more immorally, there's more and more ramifications and devastating effects of it, which means there's more and more people in need of hope. There's more kids being raised hopeless right now. But God is going to show up and sweep through the next generation. How many believe God is not finished? How many believe it's time to dream big dreams again? Speak big dreams into your kids. Breathe big dreams into them and remind them he's the one in control, Nobody else but God. Nobody else but God. Say it to somebody near you or back at me. Nobody else but God. I want to pray with you this morning, church. I hope this encourages you. The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob is still alive and well today. He's got his eye on you and on your kids and on the next generation. Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you and we love you this morning for a great time in your presence worshiping and for a reminder in your word that you are a God of multiple generations. Your heart for families, your heart for youth, your heart for generations is so vast, we can't even get it. Lord, give us a fresh revelation that when you say 1,000 generations, you mean for all time. You mean everybody. Your heart's desire is that all would come to know you. And here, for us, in our corner of the planet, where you've planted us for such a time as this, I pray that we would have the attitude of Abraham that says, I'm going to be faithful to follow his decrees. I'm going to be faithful to walk with him. I'm not going to run on my own path. I want to walk the path God has for me. Because I trust him with the next generation. I trust him with the dreams. I trust him in everything. And I show that trust by remaining faithful to him in the good times and in the bad times. Lord, for anyone who doesn't know you personally yet, they've not yet started that relationship with you, show them right now how much you love them. Show them right now that you've got a plan and a purpose and a destiny for them. For them specifically, for them, for their kids, for future generations. You see it all. And you have a great purpose and a great future. I want to give you a chance to pray a quick prayer with me here before we finish this morning. A quick prayer inviting Jesus into your life. Starting your own relationship with him. Your own journey with him. The Bible makes it clear it's a personal relationship. It's not a list of rules or ordinances or something. It's a relationship with Jesus. And I'd like you to repeat after me. I'm going to lead you in a quick prayer here that basically says that, Lord, forgive me of my sin. I invite you into my life. I want to know you. I'd love you to repeat this prayer with me. And for those of you praying this for the first time, starting your relationship with Jesus, making this decision, please click the link you'll see right there on the screen. You can click that says, I prayed this prayer. We want to make sure we get in touch with you. We get in touch with everybody who prays this prayer, and we help you start the relationship and understand what it means to have a relationship with Jesus. But church, why don't you follow along? Everybody all around the city, let's join in and pray this prayer together this morning. Dear Lord Jesus, thank you for loving me so much. Thank you for dying on the cross for me. Lord, I ask you to forgive me for anything wrong I've ever done. I want to know you personally. I want to experience your love. I want to experience your hope. Jesus, I need your hope this morning. Thank you for calling me. And thank you for loving me. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Come on, I'm pumped that you prayed that prayer. Best decision of your life right there, I assure you. Absolutely the best decision of your life. Click on the link, let us know that you prayed it, and we will get in touch with you and help you get started your journey with Jesus. Church, I love you guys. Come on, keep your eyes on him. Keep walking with Jesus. Don't get fearful. Don't get discouraged. Don't get distracted. Don't get rattled. God is on the throne, and he ain't going anywhere. He's got a great plan for you and your kids and future generations. Amen, church. Give somebody a fist pump or a high five. Those of you who are on your own, here you go. Boom, high five with me. Love y'all. We'll see you back here next weekend. God bless you.